Greetings. Psalms 8:4. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? What are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them? Psalms 8:5. For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. NIV. You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor. The New Living Translation. Yet you made them only a little lower than God, and crowned them with glory and honor. In Psalm 8, David is describing a very interesting observation, or declaring a very significant revelation. God, the creator of the universe, seems to pay special attention to mankind. What is man? What is man that you, God, are mindful of him, that you take notice of him, that you should think of him, that you should pay attention to him, that you remember him? What is man? And in the three translations I showed, there is a very different meaning conveyed. You, God, have made man a little lower than the angels, heavenly beings, or God himself. If you think about it, that is a pretty wide set of possible positions in the hierarchy of the universe. Is there one reading or translation that makes more sense than the others, is more correct? You have to go back to the original language to find out. You made him a little lower than Elohim. The word Elohim is translated God in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And given that, and the prolific usage of Elohim to mean God, you have to wonder, what does it mean that God has made man just a little lower than God himself? The implication, at least to me, is that man enjoys a primary position in God's creation. And this will certainly hair-lip the atheists and godless who have tried for a century to teach that man is nothing but another animal. Man is only a product of evolution. There is nothing unique about man in the universe, or the multiverse, if you buy into the most recent metaphysical concept being passed off as science. But the Word of God reveals exactly the opposite. What is man that thou art mindful of him? You have made him a little lower than yourself, than God. And here is where the heavy thinking begins to come into play. How hard is it to create a being that is negligibly close to an eternal being? For the moment, realize that God has no beginning and no ending. He is eternal from the infinite past to the infinite future. And God has created a being, man, that once created, will from then on exist forever. Think about that for a moment. Once created, man is now also an eternal being. The Judeo-Christian worldview and many other systems of spiritual thought assume this foundational concept. It is really only secularism or naturalism which believes there is nothing after death. As naturalism and secularism defines existence, man is nothing but a slightly more evolved biochemical mechanism, a series of biochemical interactions which appears to fulfill the definition of life somewhat incestuously defined by the same biomechanical process. Cogito, ergo sum, or I think, therefore I am, being somewhat more accurately changed to cogito, cogito, ergo cogito sum, I think, therefore I think I am. But a view of godless existence boils down to nothing more than a transitory, random interaction of atoms, and nothing more. No better or no worse, in fact, no different than a stew boiling on a stove or in a lava pit. In a conceptually coherent, godless worldview, there cannot even be a definition of right or wrong. To even attempt to declare right and wrong is to demonstrate intellectual hypocrisy. Analogous to one atom attempting to declare another atom, colliding with it, and stealing an electron, is somehow wrong. And yet, secularists and atheists yearn for such a world where nothing they do may be declared as wrong and worthy of judgment. "Oh no, atheists don't want any such thing," I can hear you say. But simply saying no does not address the very real foundation motivating secularists. What would you say about someone firing a gun into a crowd and then claiming innocence of any willful intent to harm anyone in particular? I raise this point to reveal the very fact that you are able to cogitate abstract concepts demonstrates that you are infinitely removed from the animal kingdom. And I specifically choose to say infinitely because there is an infinite distance from not having to having that ability of abstract cogitation and cognition. What is man that thou art mindful of him? You have made him a little lower than God. And yet in making man, God has also created man to exist in a limited physical reality, at least for some period of time, which may be nothing more than a limitation of the reality he created for us to exist in. So God has created an eternal being who will exist for a finite amount of time in this realm of existence, only then to transition to our eternal existence, making this temporal span virtually meaningless or nothing compared to eternity. Following so far? But what if? What if this existence is fraught with error and biological imperfection, whether original sin or the background noise from the Big Bang, or cosmic radiation, or environmental toxins, whether man-made or naturally occurring? What if it is impossible to create every human being with the same capabilities? What if humankind actually is the ultimate design that our physical time-space may accommodate? What if by creating this physical time-space, God knew that whatever sentient beings he created, not all creations would result in perfect human beings? For some reason, whatever the reason, some people would not, no, could not, possess the desire for truth. Would that demand that God create no one, so that no lesser creations existed? Does that somehow offend your human concept of fairness? Must all human beings be identical to placate your judgment of fairness? I do not think it is rational to think so. So what if it is impossible to create every human being to possess the attributes necessary to receive and discern truth? How would you go about creating and then filtering those created who pass the threshold of discernment?
Hey, hold on there, Tex. How can you say that anything is impossible for God?
Well, first you've got to put your big boy pants on and think like an adult. Realize that God not only had to create mankind and every animal species of that time, he also had to create a self-replicating process by which every life form on earth could self-create the next generation. It's a little like creating the first computer to also have the ability to reproduce itself. That is one of the fatal and damning flaws of the myth of evolution, that things can even just reproduce. As intelligent as human beings are, we are only now in the last 30 years able to create robotic machines that can potentially assemble duplicates of themselves. But only because focused, intelligent design
was applied to create that capability. Now realize that God created self-replicating machines that grow, and the machines, or bodies, are completely self-sustaining as they grow. A child of any species is not born with a fully developed skeletal system, or any other system for that matter, but they are born or created with the innate capability to grow, and the timing and development is synchronized and controlled. When that synchronization mechanism fails or has a defect, it is generally destructive for that individual organism. That is akin to our self-replicating computer producing a calculator that over time turns itself into a galaxy tablet. Think about that. And then really judge the foolishness believing all that capability happened all by itself. All animal and plant life on Earth grows not by assembling components pre-made to fit together, as you might imagine a robot assembling all the fabricated parts together according to its programmed design. No, what God has done is infinitely more complex than that. God has created biological machines that essentially assemble themselves from the basic molecules and atoms found in creation. And secularists and atheists want you to believe their unsubstantiated claim that it all happened by chaotic random accident, by random mutations happening gradually over less than 9 billion years. But until that very first molecular biological machine experienced a random chaotic mutation that not only allowed it to reproduce, but caused it to reproduce, resulted in reproduction, the myth of evolution cannot rationally even be postulated, because it assumes a process that is even less believable than a God who exists outside our perceivable reality of space-time. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.